It's 21 years since the Manic Street Preachers released their first single, Motown Junkie. It was the first of 38 to hit the charts. Since then, they produced 10 critically acclaimed albums and won numerous awards, including 4 Brits and an Ivor Novello.
So to mark the anniversary, they're releasing every track on a double CD. It's called National Treasures, the complete singles. And before we talk to Nicky Warren, James Dean Bradfield,
hello,
good morning,
Nicky,
guys.
Morning.
Let's get a sample. Here we go. And James and Nicky are here with us. Good to have you with us, boys, because you were due to come in a while ago, and one of you had you were poorly, weren't you?
Yes, I had a kind of the old singer's laryngitis again.
Well, having seen you belting
it out
in front of
a
microphone,
yeah.
No surprise, really.
I know, it's a bit wear and tear after 20 years on the road. You know?
I was going to say, it really must be, mustn't it? If you're on the road and you're singing every night and you're singing at that intensity.
Yeah, I mean, kind of, I suppose it's just that thing. At the start, you can just sing like that and you can drink some whiskey every night. And then it gets to a certain point where it's just about the singing. You can't drink any whiskey on tour, so that kind of, it's all got to be about the music.
Well, obviously. It's good to see you. Yeah. Thanks
when,
so much.
When you start as a band, then you think, right, we'll just get together, play some stuff, maybe get a couple of gigs, hope we get a recording contract, do an album, and then who knows? Did you have any idea that it was going to last this long?
Well, me and James were in school from the age of 4.
So we
were, yes, wow. 38 years.
You're still not sick of the sight of each other?
Unbelievably not. It's a pretty unnatural relationship, I know. But to be that long together, I think the 4 of us all went to the same school. We were a very tight bunch. So we did kind of have some sort of belief it was going to be important.
Yeah. Mm. But, you know, after that long, 21 years, a lot of bands decide to go their separate ways. One decides to go solo. Have you ever had those conflicts over
we had a brief period where myself and Nick did a solo record, but that was because we thought the audience was sick of us, so we took a break.
Yeah, but you got back together. Yeah.
Yeah, no, that was always the plan. But it's kind of, I think, you know, bands form and they don't really know each other, but we knew each other inside out when we formed as a band, so we knew each other's faults or weaknesses or whatever.
They're kind of any egos, because, you know, been to school in infant school, you know what we did.
He knew I was bad at maths and all that kind of stuff, you know.
38 singles, the first of which you mentioned was Motown Junk. Can you remember how did Motown Junk do in the market, so to speak?
It went straight into number 92.
Did it?
And it stayed there the second week.
That's not bad. Not bad game.
We were really thrilled.
But you are, yeah. The new album is your greatest hits, but it also includes a cover of one of our favourite songs. We love it, from Soul Mining, Ver.
Yeah.
This is the day. The news. Should we have a listen to it first?
Yeah, that's
it. And then talk about it. Here it is.
You watch a plane flying across a clear blue sky. This is the day your life will surely change. This is the day when things fall into place. You could have done anything if you wanted, and all your friends and family think that you're lucky, but the side of you they'll never see is when you're left alone with your memories that hold your life together.
Ooh,
lovely.
That's a Matt Johnson song, of course. Does it reflect then how you feel now, looking back at it all?
I think there's a sense of melancholia, kind of glorious melancholia in that song, which is always what we've been kind of good at,
being
Welsh. I think it's natural to
yes.
us. Yeah, and it just, the lyrics do kind of evoke some sort of sentimentality, but you know, in a positive way.
Mm. Yeah, and perhaps some sadness in the band as well, because of Richie, of course.
Yeah, I mean, every time we do stuff like this, you see, you know, amazing images, how cool he looked, more special person he was to everyone, you know, so it's always going to be that bittersweet.
Yeah. Have you always, I get the impression, though, that you still carry his spirit in the band.
Well, the important thing to realise when it initially happened was is that we could never replace him, because he was utterly unique in every way, So, kind of, you know, there's a space on the stage, which is always remains vacant, you know, it's his space. And we just didn't try to do what he did. You know, Nick didn't try to replicate his lyrics. He kind of wrote in his style, which he'd always done. And I knew there was no danger of me trying to look like him.
Yeah.
So kind of like, you know, we just kind of paid our homage in that kind of way.
Yeah. People don't remember what he disappeared in 1995, didn't he? Is that right?
It's a long time ago.
Yeah. You said he was in really good spirits at the time and in good heart. Yeah. And, you know, I know you said in the past that that's something that you try to keep in the band as well.
I mean, we just, as a person, he was just such a fierce intellectual, but someone also you could watch a rugby with, you know. And he wasn't just a member of the band, he was someone's son, someone's brother. Mm. You know, it's obviously you see him as a kind of rock icon, but he was much more than that.
Mm. To celebrate, then, your 21 years, you're doing a special event.
We are.
Tell us about it.
We're getting really panicky about it, because we're playing all 38 songs, which...
How many songs do you normally sing in a gig?
It's around about 24 usually, isn't it?
Yeah.
So it's usually about hour 45, and this is going to be about 3.25 hours. So there's a break in the middle where people can kind of go and get their pre-ordered drinks at the bar, at the theatre, and we'll have some oxygen and massage at the side of the stage. We're getting a wee bit scared.
Yeah.
And I might have to have a teleprompter with all the lyrics.
Yeah.
Well, it's
the Rolodex not working.
Standard operating procedure these days.
If you've got any tips.
You'll know it. It's in your DNA. We saw a couple of your Polaroids flashing up a little earlier. Tell us about that.
Well, since the band started, really, just for my mum and dad, they always used to have Polaroid family albums, so I've taken about 6,000 or 10,000 of them over the last...
What? 6,000 or 10,000?
Yeah, me and my Japanese photographer, Michi Kida, and so I put them all together in a book. I've had to edit them, obviously.
Yeah. They fade, though, don't they, Polaroids?
That's the beauty of them. They're like memories. They fade.
Yes, that's true.
Living art.
And
all right.
A big book of them now, as you're saying.
Thank you very much, guys.
Lovely to see
pleasure.
You.
Pleasure.
Thanks very much for coming in.
National Treasures, the complete singles, is out now, and the band will be performing all 38 songs, as I mentioned, at the London O2 on December the 17th. The book, Death of a Polaroid, a Mannix family album, published on November the 17th.